would like to live in Hawaii because of its fucking land. Also because of its oceans for swimming, its beautifully colored flowers, shady palm trees, and its waterfalls. I would also like to live there because of its pretty sights like the Aloha Tower, Bracken Sand, which is a beach, Sea Life Park, Pearl Harbor, and their national parks. Also because of their hospitality, and I would like to see the elevator stands.
I would like to live in Montreal because it is an excellent place to live. First, when I get there, I would take a drive down to the Forum and watch a Montreal Canadiens game and get some autographs of the players. After the game, I would settle in the most expensive hotel and have a great time. In the morning, I would get up around, I would get up early, like 5 o'clock, and take a subway downtown to one of the greatest malls and go sightseeing. I would also take a lot of pictures and send postcards to my friends and families. I would spend most of my time cruising around town and having a good time.
Hawaii has a nice warm climate in the summer all year round. Hawaii has sandy beaches, warm gentle breezes, swaying palm trees, and loud rushing waterfalls. Also, coral beaches, a rolling white surf, acres of green plants, gray-colored flowers, and giant fern forests. Hawaii has such a spectacular beauty. They have different festivals or festivities there, such as the luau. I would go there and watch the hula dancers and listen to their Hawaiian music and maybe even eat some sugar cane. I would take a midnight stroll down the beach and listen to the crashing waves. I would go surfing, water skiing, windsurfing, scuba diving, and swimming in the wonderfully warm waters. Hawaii is located roughly in the middle of the Pacific Ocean. It is not one island, but a chain of 8 islands. It is halfway between continental America and the Far East countries. Thank you.
Life in Judic is the kind of life that I always want. To me, living in a small place is much better than a big city. Here in Judic, we know all of our neighbors. We play together, share our toys, books, and tapes. In a large city, we would not even know where our school friends lived. All I have to do is cross the road and walk a little ways and end up at the tennis courts. Here we can play all we want without it costing anything. We go a little further and arrive at the ball field, the track, or the playground. If we lived in the city, we would have to go with our parents. It would be very expensive for our family to enjoy these places. In the summer, we can enjoy the best beaches by driving to Port Hood. This is why a lot of tourists come to Cape Breton. They enjoy our beautiful beaches and the way that we live better than the fast-going place of the city. Most people in the cities would trade places with us if they could find work here. The cities have the jobs, the stores, the subway, the crime, and the money. We may never be rich with money, but we are rich in many other ways. I will always know that no matter where I live in a few years, that Judic will always be my first and my best home.
Good afternoon, Mrs. Chisholm and fellow classmates. If I could choose to live anywhere in the world, I would choose Scotland, the home of my ancestors. Scotland is a land rich in culture, beauty, and talent. Scotland is located in Great Britain. It is a beautiful country with its industrial cities, fishing, villages, farms, harbors, and parks. The Scottish people have long been famous for their close-knit clans, colorful plaid-kilt, and skillless fierce warriors. Scotland is full of myths and legends. I've always wondered if there really is a Loch Ness monster. If I lived in Scotland, I would be able to visit Loch Ness to see the home of this famous creature people have claimed to see in the lake. Scotland's rugged mountains, green valleys, and deep blue lakes provide some of the most beautiful scenery in the world. When my younger sister Katie was baptized, a lady from a group of islands called the Hebrides came to my home. She told me of her home, a thatched cottage with sheep running all about. I've never forgotten Mary McNeil or her invitation to visit. I'd like to share the hospitality she spoke of and see the beauty she so lovingly described. I have taken several sessions of step dancing. I'd like to be able to find out the origins of Scottish music and dance. In winter, I'd like to ski down Scotland's rugged mountains and slopes. If Scotland were to become my homeland, I do not think I would ever be lonesome. Scotland would be my home away from home, for for the beauty, scenery, music, talent, and hospitality. They are so similar to what I now experience here in Jordan. I don't think I would ever be lonely. Thank you.
Good afternoon, Mrs. Chisholm, fellow classmates. The place I would like to live is in a gigantic yacht in the Caribbean Sea. The reasons I would like to live in a gigantic yacht in the Caribbean Sea is because I could sail to Jamaica, Cuba, Hispania, St. June, Antigua, Bermuda, and all the other hot and beautiful islands along the Caribbean. Also because I could take it easy sitting out on one of the decks doing some fishing and enjoying the air. Other reasons are that I would lay on all the white sand on the beaches of all those places, and I could go on scuba diving under my boat and see all the kinds of things. I could also go on shark hunts with some friends, and I could have parties all the time and invite my friends to them all. I would also like to live in the Caribbean Sea because I wouldn't have to worry about getting caught in traffic jams or anything like that, and I wouldn't have to worry about getting caught for speeding. Thank you.
Good morning, Mrs. Chisholm and fellow classmates. I'd like to talk to you about living in a city. I'd like to live in a city because of the malls and many restaurants to choose from. There are many things to do and things to see. Also, I'd like to live in a city because there are many people to talk to. But also, I would not like to live in a city because people take drugs and alcohol, mostly in cities. Also, many people get beaten up or sometimes even murdered. In the country, there is none of this, so I think for right now, or until I'm old enough to protect myself from these things, I'd like to live right here in Greenwich.
Good afternoon. Thank you. Now, for the afternoon.
I'm living now, and everything is running jetting. I like living here because most of my family and friends are around here, and if I moved away, I would miss them and hardly see them. I also like staying around here because there is beautiful scenery and fresh air. Whereabouts, if I moved away, the scenery might not be as lovely and the air might be polluted. I don't want to move away because everyone knows everyone around here, and I know that no one around here would hurt you. So if I moved away, I would not know anybody and I would not know if they would hurt me or not. Most of all, I want to stay around here because I go to school here and I lived here most of my life. Thank you. Good morning, Ms. Chisholm. Good afternoon, Ms. Chisholm and fellow classmates. The place I'd like to live in is Toronto, because that's where I want to play hockey. I chose Toronto because it is a nice city. Toronto is where I want to play hockey and baseball. Toronto is a nice place to live. You can walk down the street and enjoy this beautiful scenery. They also have nice buildings, restaurants, stores, and sports shops. I also like the cities because I love the sound of cars driving by when I wake up in the morning. Thank you.
Good morning, Mrs. Chisholm and fellow classmates. If I could live anywhere in the world, except Jiddick, of course, I would live in Florida. Could you imagine having Disney World right in your own backyard? I could go there anytime I wanted, make good friends with Mickey and all his pals. I could go surfing, boogie boarding, swimming, scuba diving, windsurfing, and many other enjoyable water sports in July and December. Mom could never tell me to put on ski pants, a heavy jacket, boots, or turtlenecks because it would always be warm. On your way to school, there would be no ice or slush to slip on and get soaked. And while you're probably in school, you'd probably get soaked even more. Sports like football, soccer, baseball, and tennis would go on all year round. School might even be fun. Good afternoon, Ms. Chisholm and fellow classmates. I'd like to live under the sea because I could fight octopuses, sea monsters, and giant squid. And if I want to go swimming, I would just have to go out my front door. I could take my friends
into maybe Blackbeard's ship if I could find it. Or take them exploring deep caves under the water engraved in rocks. I could eat fish and I could maybe see King of the Sea. I would also collect clam shells and nice rocks that might be worth something. And it would be adventurous and exciting. I could take my friends surfing, skidoo driving, and boogie boarding on the surface. And it is quiet. Thank you.
Good morning, Mrs. Chisholm and fellow classmates. The place I would like to live the most is where I live now, in Memorial Park. The reason why I would like to live here is because most of my friends and family live here. Because I have nice neighbors that will help you if you need them to. There is also a nice scene of the ocean 5 miles where lots of tourists stop and take pictures. And there is lots of land where to play sport and build things you would like to. Where I am living now, there is no violence, people on drugs, or people getting beaten, or even murdered. And that is why I like to live in my life.
Good morning, Mrs. Chisholm and fellow classmates. The topic I have chosen to speak on is where I would like to live. The place I have chosen to pick is Austin, Texas. Austin is the capital city of Texas. It is known for its famous Waco Temple building. I would like to live in Austin because I like country air and country music. Austin was made for cowboys. I have two uncles that were in Texas. They said it was great. Although that summer and many other summers, the water goes practically dry. The land and air is also very dry. In Texas, you can watch the rodeos. Texas is known for its cowboy-like ways. Texas also produced country music singers such as Willie Nelson. I will one day hope to live in Austin, Texas, but for now, I'm happy. Happy where I live. Thank you.
Good morning, it's Justin and Fal Cosmo. Where I like to live is in Hollywood because it's nice because you can make movies and you can make movies tourists. When I was in Hollywood, I would like to see Bruce Springsteen and you can smell nice fresh air and land. I would like to stay in a expensive hotel and old room service. After that, I will take a drive in my Porsche, and I will go to the beach and surf. That's where I like to live in Hollywood.
Good morning, Mrs. Chisholm and fellow classmates. I would like to live in the jungle. Life in a jungle would be very adventurous and exciting. And plus, food there is better than it ever was here. For breakfast, I could have fried roots and pineapple juice. For lunch, I could have fried piranhas and eucalyptus leaves. And for supper, I could have coconuts, vine juice, and grapes. For fun, I could play coconut ball with the natives and hunt for gorillas. And I could also swim from vine to vine with Tarzan. I could catch a python or two, and if they don't kill me, I could teach them to hunt for animals and bring them back to me. And that is why I'd like to live in the jungle.
And a nice school and a beautiful church. What I really like about Jeddah is that the people are friendly and always ready to help each other. To me, that is very important. Most of our parents have worked near or in Jeddah. Because of this, families enjoy many things together. In the summer, that means picnics, and in the winter, we can skate, coast, and ski together. fortunate to enjoy living in Japan.
Brian, we're ready. Come on. Well, whatever you have, get up there, kid. You were supposed to have this ready today.
Morning, Mrs. Chisholm, fellow classmates. The place I would like to live is in Craignish. I would like to live in Craignish because it is a peaceful place and lots of my friends live there. And the people are very nice to me because I know this because I lived there for 7 years. There's lots of things to do. And if you're bored, you could go up to Craignish Pit and watch people go around there on dirt bikes. Thank you.
Good morning, Ms. Chisholm and fellow classmates. The topic I have chosen to speak about is about our new horse, Kazerk. Kazerk was born in Edmonton in 1984. On June 8th, my Uncle Ronnie sent Kazerk from Edmonton. Kazerk was his horse. As you know, a trip from Edmonton to Jiddick would take a lot out of a horse. It would take a lot out of you. Well, it takes more out of a horse. The horse has to stand up all the way. To get back his strength, twice a day we take him swimming. And soon we'll jog him. You might wonder how we swim them. Well, my oldest sister, Allison, puts on her wetsuit, ties a rope to the horse's halter, and swims out in the water with him. This way, he will regain his strength, slowly but safely. For most people, it would take them a year to learn how to swim. Not Kazerk. It only took him 3 days. This surprised me, because he never saw the ocean before. Of course, the horse has to eat. What does he eat? Well, first, he can have all the hay and water he wants. Then twice a day, Dad will give him 1 gallon of oats and 2 gallons of horse feed. In the evening, Dad will take the horse for a short walk. While he's doing this, somebody will have to clean his stall. Yuck. In about a month, he will be able to race again. Even though we go through all of this, I took a quick liking to the horse, even though he's too big to hug. Thank you.
Good morning, Ms. Chisholm and fellow classmates. The topic that I've chosen to talk about is comedians and humor. This is not Why Did the Chicken Cross the Road? This is Eddie Murphy, Red Skelton, Joe Turnbelt, and Richard Pryor. This is comedy. Eddie Murphy is my favorite. He acts in many good movies, such as Coming to America, I had seen that, Beverly Hills Cop 1 and 2, and his comedy is great in these films. Eddie Murphy also stars in many comedy shows such as Delirious, Raw, Saturday Night Live. In these, his humor is so funny. Out of all the comedians in the world, I say that Eddie Murphy is the greatest. Red Skelton is about 74 and still cream of the crop. He is funny when he tells a joke. He laughs more than the audience. Also, I think my grandfather likes him. I'm not sure, but he is quite good. Joe Turnbelt is not a bad guy, but he has a tendency to offend people. He has another tendency to shoot his mouth off. Otherwise, he's not a bad guy. He's just as good as Eddie Murphy. Richard Pryor is about as good as Eddie Murphy and is a friend. He has a new movie, See No Evil, Hear No Evil. This is sure to get box hits. Eddie Murphy is still my favorite. He has just the right touch for comedy. Eddie has guts to talk about bigger people, such as Arnold Schwarzenegger. Like, for instance, in Raw, he said quite a lot of things about Arnie, like, why is his chin so far out, and how can he hold his head up? And so on. I like him because he has just the right touch for comedy, and he is almost as great as Grant Fuhrer. I can't talk about Fabulous Fjord, but I know comedy when I hear it, and you'll laugh at this. His name is Patrick Waugh. Thank you.
Okay, just a moment, please. I'm going to...
Good morning, Mrs. Chisholm and fellow classmates. The topic of my speech is friends. Friends are very special and very important people. They help you with things such as your homework. You can talk to them about almost anything, and they're always there when you need them. Friends are great companions. When you're with them, you can forget all your problems or worries. They understand you, they can keep your secrets, and they're fun to be with. They can make you laugh, but sometimes they can make you angry. They will help you through your sad times and share with you your glad times. No one in the world could live without friends. Friends will do things for you. You know when a friend is really a friend. They don't care how pretty or plain you are or by the clothes you wear or don't wear. Friends like you for who you are. Friends will stick up for you when you're in trouble or need help. They'll lend you a helping hand, and you can always rely on them, those people we call friends. Why God made friends. God made the world with a heart full of love, then he looked down from heaven above and saw that we all need a helping hand, someone to share with who will understand. He made special people to see us through the glad times and the sad times too, a person who we can always depend, someone we can call a friend. God made friends so we'll carry a part of his perfect love in all our hearts.
Okay, so I'm going to just stop there for a minute. And I am
You're
going
to... You're not taping over other speeches, are you?
No.
Play back.
I'm going to rewind that.
I don't want us coming home.
Joanne, you're right up.
Good morning, Ms. Chisholm and fellow classmates. The topic I'd like to speak on is hockey. How hockey is played. Hockey is a sport played in Canada and the United States. There are 21 different teams. One team in Canada and 7 in the United States. 14 in the United States and 7 in Canada. There are 20 to 25 people on a team. Six on the ice at one time. There's a goalie that stays near his own net and stops the shots of the opposing players. Then there's the defenseman. They also stay back in their own end most of the time and stop the shots and try to keep the puck out of their own end. Then the forwards. They are to keep the puck in the opponent's end and to score the goals for their team. The length of the game is an hour divided up into 3 20-minute periods with a 10-minute rest in between. If the score happens to be tied at the end of the third period, we go into an overtime period. Once one of the teams scores, they automatically win the game. Then there's the referees. They're also on the ice. They call the penalties. The penalties when a player trips, holds, fights, or roughing. If you get a penalty, you sit in the penalty box for up to 2 minutes. If you hurt the player badly, you will go in for 5 minutes.
Good morning, Ms. Chisholm and fellow classmates. The topic I've chosen to speak on is the war. The war starts when two places disagree on something and declare a war. Two armies line up in the field of face each other in the field of battle and fight until one army kills the other. People who survive the first war go into the second, if they're still living. There are all different kinds of wars. There is a world war, a civil war, a nuclear war, Vietnam, and Saigon. There was two major wars in the world, World War I and World War II. World War I began as a war of movement in 1914 to 1918, but a stalemate developed after the first few weeks. Each side suffered enormous casualties and tried to branch off the other's defenses. New weapons, such as the airplanes and the Sherman tank, were introduced. A sea warfare then was revolutionized by a submarine. World War II began in 1939 to 1945. World War II marked the return of the war of movement. The Germans won with great success and employed massive tanks with Napoleon boldness in Poland and France. In conclusion, war should not be fought on the beautiful plains of land and scenery of Canada and Southern America. Why should people risk their lives to prove they're better than other countries or places? They should just get a TV connection and tell each other what they dislike, or they could do this anonymously by telephone. Thank you.
Good morning, Ms. Chisholm and fellow classmates. The topic I've chosen to speak on is store forest industries in our forest. Forestry has been one of the main industries in Nova Scotia. It supplies us with paper for school, wood for firewood, and it also supplies people with jobs and a source of income. Store forest industries in Point Tupper is one of the main industries in Nova Scotia. It manages about 570,000 hectares of forested land in 7 eastern counties in Nova Scotia. The forest is a place for taking a nice long walk in and to see all the beautiful scenery. The trees are also used to build a house, boat, cabins, and maybe even a treehouse. Store Forest Industries planted more than 60 million trees during the last 25 years. In many cities, the trees are being destroyed by forest fires and careless campers. At the mill, you can go and buy baby seedlings to replant new trees. As early as the 18th century, the early settlers used trees to build their homes, heat their homes, and a way of travel. There are many trees in Cape Breton that were standing for hundreds of years, and if someone just went and cut them down, all the trees there would be no more trees left. We also use trees for making sets for a play or a festival. The forest has also supported many animals for their homes and food. Store Forest Industry started in 1962 and has grown into a very large industry. The forest is a place that is very peaceful and is a place we don't want to destroy.
Good morning, Mrs. Chisholm and fellow classmates. The topic that I've chosen is Allen Guinness. All young boys and girls dream to be famous. Most boys dream to play hockey in the NHL. There are not very many people that get to play in the NHL, especially when you live in a small place like Fort Hood, where there are not very many opportunities, as like in big cities and towns. Allen McGinnis is a very good hockey player. He got the Trophy for being the most valuable player in the playoffs. He was also the leading scorer in the playoffs. He was also up for best defenseman but lost it to Chris Chelios. Al McGinnis was with the Calgary Flames for 8 years. He also set a couple of records for defensemen. He is the first Nova Scotian to get the Conn Smythe Trophy. Thursday's win left him 1 game short of tying the NHL playoff record. He did break Bobby Orr's record for defenseman. He scored in 17 straight games. He became the first defenseman to lead all playoff scorers with 31 points. McGinnis was the first defenseman to get the playoff scoring crown. He was famous for his very hard slap shots. Many of the players don't want to be in the way of his slap shots. On July 29th at Fort Hood, they are having Allen McGinnis Day. This is a dinner followed by a dance for adults. People there get to meet Al McGinnis in person. Al McGinnis also got named Inverness's first citizen of the year. This is the first time Al McGinnis and the Calgary Flames ever won the Stanley Cup, but this year it won't be their last year either. Thank you.
Good morning, Mrs. Chisholm and fellow classmates. It's a lot of fun. When you go to compete, you meet a lot of new friends. Sometimes you win, and sometimes you don't. You move up in divisions after you get so many medals. When you are 6 years or younger, you are a baby. You need 6 medals to move out of beginner, then you're in novice intermediate. After that, you move into advanced. You must stay in advanced for 1 year. After the year is up, you move into open. Open is the highest division that you can get in. I move into open July 1st. Dancing is a lot of fun. When you're in dancing, you travel a lot. You also have to change into a lot of different outfits. Competitions are a lot of fun. You go in the morning and you leave in the afternoon. You meet some new friends and you meet some old ones. You have to work very hard to be the best. You have to practice for at least an hour every day. I enjoy dancing very much. You must have confidence in yourself if you want to be good. When you are in dancing for a while, you get more confident in yourself and it becomes easier for you to do. Thank you.
Good morning, Mrs. Chisholm and fellow classmates. The topic I've chosen to speak about is little things we take for granted. As you grow older, you take more and more things for granted. You think you don't need education anymore and you tend to slack off. And you think studying is just looking it all over. What use is studying anyway? Eventually, you're going to grade, right? Wrong. When you take education for granted, and a lot of times, taking it for granted leads to problems. Your parents try to help you and try to make you do the right things, but to you, it's all junk. Who cares about school, how late you're out with your friends, or how much water and power you waste? It's their money, so what? With you using all their money, when you need a certain amount of it, you can't get it because of the water and power being wasted. Your parents are the most important people in your lives, and you should treat them with respect. They deserve all the dignity and respect they can get. Your parents made you the way you are today. They care a great deal about you, and you should do the same. Who brought you into this world? Your parents are your friends, just like people in your class, in school, or anywhere. Parents, though, have a special friendship with you. At times, you don't realize that parents are the best friends you can have. Don't take your parents for granted, because someday you might need them. Food and clothing are important in our lives every day. Today, though, we think eating fast foods and wearing the latest fashions mean everything. But what we should be thinking about is that we are able to have food and clothing on the table. All over the world, people are starving and have no clothing. We should be very thankful that we are able to have these. Our health is so important to us. We never realize that we are healthy, unlike children around the world today. We don't have diseases breaking out. Our community is clean, the air is fresh. We take our health for granted quite a bit, and someday we might become deathly sick and then realize how lucky we were. So now you can see how many little things we all take for granted as we grow older. Thank you.
Good morning, Ms. Chisholm and fellow classmates. The topic that I'm going to talk about today is prejudice. The first type of prejudice that I'm going to talk about is prejudice against blacks. Many people are against blacks for some reason or another. People may be against blacks because they think they're no good or that they're awful people who usually end up in street gangs. Maybe it's just simply because they think that blacks are no good and that they are different. A long time ago, some people were against blacks too, so they used some as slaves. The blacks didn't get good wages from their bosses, so they couldn't send their children to school. Then, when a black was found reading, he or she was severely punished. Still today, some people are prejudiced against blacks. They may pick fights with them, call them names, put them down, and criticize them. People who do that are the ones who should be punished. There are many other kinds of prejudice going on in the world. For example, some people might be prejudiced against people who are overweight. Even if they are not prejudiced against them, they still might pick on them, just because their friends are doing it and they don't want to be left out, even if it means hurting another person. Some may call overweight people cruel names or talk and laugh at them behind their backs. Maybe some people can't help being overweight, and you can really hurt them by picking on them so much. That person may even eat less or become anorexic to lose some weight so nobody will pick on her anymore.
I wanted to talk about this topic because I think you should take a colored person or an overweight person the way they are and for who he or she is. Thank you.
Good morning, Ms. Chisholm and fellow classmates. The topic that I have chosen is the Los Angeles Kings. The Los Angeles Kings are my favorite hockey team. They have a real good goalie, Kelly Rudy. They got lots of good players like Wayne Gretzky, Luke Robitaille, Bernie Nichols, Jim Fox, Ron DeGate, and Dave Taylor. They came in second place this year behind the Calgary Flames in the Smythe Division. In the first round of the playoffs, they put out the Edmonton Oilers in 7 games. And then in the second round, they got put out by the Calgary Flames in 4 straight games. They did a lot better this year than they did last year. Last year, they were almost in last place. They were lucky that they got Wayne Gretzky this year. They had Wayne Gretzky and Bernie Nichols in the top 5 scorers. This year, Wayne Gretzky got his 9th Hart Trophy. They fired the coach and are looking for a new coach. Last year, they had 2 rookies, Luke Robitaille and Jimmy Carson, who were in the top 10 point scorers. Jimmy Carson is now with the Edmonton Oilers. Next year, the Los Angeles Kings will have a better team. They'll have a new coach and will work a lot harder. They just might win the Stanley Cup.
Okay, begin.
Good morning, Ms. Chisholm and fellow classmates. The topic that I've chosen to write my speech upon is hockey and I started hockey when I was 4 years old, and I have been a defenseman ever since I started. When I was 5, I went to hockey school in Prince Edward Island, and I've been going there every year since. This year will be my 8th year there. I have also gone to the Port Hood Hockey School for 3 years, and I still go to the Allie McDonald Hockey School in Anacondish, and I've been going there for the past 5 years. Also, I have gone to the Strait Area Hockey School in Pittsburgh for the last 6 years. Detroit, Ontario, St. Andrews, New Brunswick, Sydney, Dalhousie, and the College of Cape Breton have also sent me letters wanting me to go to their hockey schools. Every year I get new letters from different places. As you all know, ever since I started hockey, I've been a defenseman, and I enjoy being one very much. I like hitting and checking. Being a defenseman is one of the toughest positions in hockey. It is a tough position to play because the forwards and goaltenders depend on you to stop anyone coming down the ice. When you are a defenseman, you do not get many goals, just assists. Also in tournaments, they usually give the MVP to forwards who scored a lot of the goals, while a defenseman has stopped everyone that has come down the ice and set up all of that forwards' plays. But covering the good sides and bad sides of being a defenseman, I still love to play that position, and that's what I'm good at. Thank you.
Good morning, Mrs. Chisholm and fellow classmates. The topic I have chosen to speak upon today is the Montreal Canadiens. Hockey is a great, interesting sport, and Montreal is one of the best teams. Although Calgary Flames won the Stanley Cup this year, Montreal has won the most Stanley Cups in the history of hockey. But of all Montreal's games for the Stanley Cup, they have won 21 out of 24. I myself was going for Montreal Canadiens. Montreal has a lot of good players, such as Larry Robinson, who is a great defenseman, and Mats Naslund, who is a great left wing, and Chris Chelios, who is also a great defenseman, and Stefan Richey, who is a great forward, and all other Montreal players are great too. Montreal has been known to play under pressure and win at the last minute. They have won Stanley Cups when the other team has won 3 games and Montreal none. I am still going for Montreal, and I hope they win another Stanley Cup next year. They are one of the most liked teams in hockey. They have been called the Habs. Their uniforms are red, white, and blue, and their symbol is a C with a H in the middle. Thank you.
Good morning, Mrs. Chisholm and fellow classmates. I have chosen to tell you about the importance of TVs and radios. TVs and radios are important because if we didn't have TVs or radios, how would we know what's happening around the world or right around our community? Televisions let us see what's happening around us, and radios let us hear what's happening around us. If we had neither of these, we would have no way of knowing what was happening. We would not know when things are happening or when important people are coming to the area. We wouldn't know about people starving or accidents. We wouldn't know the weather report, if the bus is late, or our school's canceled. Your family and friends would be mixed up and everyone would have a different story about the same thing. If there was a TV or a radio, everyone would have the right idea about the right story. TV also gives us entertainment, laughter, and fun. We can watch game shows, cartoons, movies, and more. During the summer, we have field events on TV, such as sprinting, car racing, parachutes, and more. During the winter, we can watch sports like hockey, skating, skiing, bobsledding. You can see how the Calgary Flames are doing, or any other team. On the radio, we can listen to the sports. Also on the radio, we have contests, weather, and more. TVs and radios are a good source of information. You get to have fun with game shows. It brings families closer together because when you watch the show, you get to enjoy the laughing, crying, and other emotions about a program. So without TVs or radios, life would be informative. Don't you agree? So don't forget to turn on the TV or the radio. Don't take that for granted. Thank you.
Monday. Everybody smile. Joanne looks. Aaron and Bradley, put your hands down here. Everybody smile. Angus? Roger, put your hand down, please.
She was a frail girl, and her large muscular brothers teased her and tormented her. She learned at a young age to be daring. Anything they could do, she tried to do better. When Elizabeth's father died, she and her mother moved to Pittsburgh. In 1885, not yet 20 years old, Elizabeth, who wanted to become a writer, read an article in the Pittsburgh Dispatch titled, What Girls Are Good For. At this time, women were not allowed to vote, and only a few jobs were available to them. The article was strongly opposed to women's rights and have careers outside of the home. Elizabeth was infuriated and wrote a stinging rebuke to the editor. George Madden, who had written the article, was so impressed by the anonymous letter that he ran an advertisement in the paper asking the writer to contact him. Ben wanted to hire the writer as a reporter for the newspaper, but when he discovered that Elizabeth was a woman, he almost changed his mind. In spite of himself, though, he offered her a job. Elizabeth's name, however, could not appear on the article she would write. She had to use a pen name, so she chose Nellie Bly, taken from a popular song by Stephen Foster. Nellie wanted to write from first-hand experiences about social iniquity. She went into the Pittsburgh slums, factories, hospitals, orphanages, and prisons. And she wrote about the dismal working and living conditions she encountered. Her writings engaged the public in public interest, but enraged the businessmen who ran the places she wrote about. Madden encouraged Nellie to take a vacation. Nellie headed for New York, where she was turned away from many newspapers just because she was a woman. Finally, she convinced Joseph Pulitzer and John T. Cockrell to put her on the staff at the World. She promised them a story about the city's insane asylum, Black Wills Island. Nellie's sensational Black Wills Island story prompted an investigation. Reforms were sent in, and the city improved the institution. But Nellie was just beginning. Disguised, she exposed fraud and employee agencies, framed herself in a theft charge with a friend, and got arrested. She wrote about the injustices to women prisoners. She threw herself off a ferry boat to test the efficiency of the rescue group. She exposed a corrupt lobbyist, and she encouraged women to demand their rights. Still, no one knew Nellie's true identity, and many people believed Nellie was really a team of men reporters. Around the World in 80 Days by Jules Verne was a popular book in the 1880s. Nellie wanted to outdo the speed record set by Verne's fictional hero, Phileas Fogg. Pulitzer thought it was a good idea, but wanted to send a man. When Nellie said she would take the trip for another newspaper, Pulitzer relented. She set out from New Jersey on November 14, 1889, and arrived back in New Jersey exactly 72 days, 6 hours, and 10 minutes later. She had beaten the record. Nellie continued to write articles for the World until 1895, when she married Robert L. Seaman, a New York businessman. They lived quietly in New York until Seaman's death in 1910. Nellie was in Australia during the outbreak of World War I. She returned to the United States in 1990 and was hired by the New York Journal. When Nellie died 3 years later of pneumonia, the Journal paid her a tribute she would have been proud of, said she was considered the best reporter in America.
Our project is on Muhammad Ali, the great.
Muhammad Ali became the second heavyweight champion to regain his title. Ali became the title by knocking out George Foreman, the defending champion, in 1974. Floyd Patterson was the only other heavyweight champion to lose to regain his title. Muhammad Ali won the championship by knocking out Sonny Fitz in 1964. Some boxing groups recognized Ali as a champion. After he defeated Ernie Farrell in 1967, in the same year, in the same year, the WBA and the other boxing groups stripped Ali of his title after he was convinced on charges of refusing introduction to the USA Army.
After his conviction, Ali didn't box for 3.5 years. In 1971, he suffered his first loss in 32 professional fights when he attempted to regain the heavyweight title against Joe Frazier. Later in 1971, the Supreme Court of the USA reversed Ali's conviction. Ali was from Kansas Clay in Louisville, Kentucky. He became a pro boxer after winning the light heavyweight title at the 1960 Summer Olympic Games. In 1964, he adopted the Black Muslim religion and changed his name to Muhammad Ali. He discussed his boxing career and religious views in his autobiography, The Greatest, My Own Story. Ali became one of the most colorful and controversial champions in boxing history. He bragged about his ability and made poems that scorned his opponents. Early in his career, Ali even predicted the round he would defeat his opponent.
When John F. Kennedy was very young, he was smart and also educated at 4 schools for various reasons, such as playing football, visiting his father for business reasons, for good education, etc. Through these years, the boy displayed an inquisitive mind and retentive memory, but in different work habits, hurt his grades, which were only average. In football, he was dedicated, if somewhat lightweight, competitor. In swimming, he displayed the same fierce determination to win. And during the boyhood summers, he became a small but excellent boat sailor. John F. Kennedy's parents came from the two most powerful Irish families,
in Boston politics. Their marriage produced 9 children, all of who were imbued with courage, responsibility, competitive spirit, and loyalty to their parents. In 1936, John Kennedy entered Harvard. During the first 2 years, he achieved little academic distinction. But by midpoint of his college career, something happened which was to vastly alter his attitude. His father was appointed ambassador of England by President Franklin D. Roosevelt. As a result, John spent the summer following his freshman year in Europe, where the first time he saw a world living under tension. He suffered a bad back injury during football. When it was healed, it did not stop him in sports. Not long after, they accepted him to spend the second semester serving his father as a secretary. John Kennedy moved his way up to the naval force. Kennedy received the Navy and Marine Corps Medal for duty that was in the highest traditions of the naval service. Kennedy also saved a crew of men in the PT-109, a boat at the time of war. The ship wasn't running very good, and they got stuck with it. They saw a ship at a direction 2 o'clock at the imagery struck them and sliced through the wooden boat. The gas exploded everywhere, and one of the uninjured gathered them all up, except 2 that were never found. Kennedy towed them, severely injured, to safety. Kennedy identified 3 islands and then tried to get help. Kennedy and the crew made some suggestions to get some help or help themselves. Then Kennedy got an idea and moved to the island closest to them. They spent 6 days without food or shelter. They tried communicating, but failed. 4 days went by and had no contact until Kennedy used his famous coconut message. He carved a message and threw it out in the water. A day and a half later, a PT boat from Brandova took them off to safety. If it wasn't for Kennedy, they would have died. In 1945, he got into talking about being president. He paid $250,000 just for a campaign. He got in from everyone's votes and was a great hit. Once he got in, he married Jacqueline Kennedy. A few years later, there were 3 crises. 1, the Berlin Wall. 2, Meredith at Old Miss. And 3, Cuba brinks of war. Kennedy worked hard at each one, and even got some help from other people, and beat each one. The fatal bullet was shot by the assassin Lee Harvey Oswald on November 22, 1963. He laid on his wife's lap when shot. Everybody was hysterical, crying, screaming. Even people around here were crying that day. Even today, they aren't sure if it was Lee Harvey Oswald or not. Thank you.
Stop.
Napoleon was born on August 15th, 1769, on an island of Corsica. Stop. The son of Mary. Ronna Pert and Ladislav Palomino. At the age of 10, he joined military school. When he reached 16, he received a commissionary as a second lieutenant of artillery in January 1786. His first act as military man consisted of
surrounding and falling of Tulum, a heavily guarded English area. For this, he was promoted October 5th, 1795. He was appointed Barras second in command. On the day of March 9th, 1796, Napoleon married Josephine, a girl from the West Indies. Six years older than Napoleon, but he was determined to love her. Later in that year, he was called to command the army of Italy. He and his army raged through Italy, defeating ally after ally, and forcing them back. In 1797, he defeated Australia, forcing them to surrender. More men were jealous of heroics of Napoleon and tried everything to get rid of him. On July 1798, France, under Napoleon, invaded Egypt. The Turks declared war on France. The British cut off Napoleon's army's food supplies. The Turkish, and the Russians formed an alliance. The Austrians then re-entered the war, but again they were defeated, although just barely this time. In May of 1804, the French Senate voted him employer. On December 2nd, 1805, he smashed the Cuban and Austrian armies at Austria.
When Napoleon returned to Paris, he divorced Josephine and remarried Archduchess Marie Louise. In 1811, she bore him a son, but things weren't so good on the battlefield. He was losing to the Allies. Napoleon lost his throne, and he was exiled, but for less than a year. Later, he returned to France and once again took control. He attacked Wellington at Waterloo, but the British defeated him. He fled, but was captured and exiled once again, this time to St. Helena, where he later died of cancer.
Grant Fiore is one of the best goalies in the NHL, and he led his team to 5 Stanley Cup finals in 2004. Grant Fiore says playing under pressure does not affect his stopping abilities. Grant Fiore said that pressure is a myth and that a lot of goalies like Mike Brennan, Patrick Waugh, Kelly Rudy have problems with pressure. Fiore is goalie for the greatest team in the NHL and is accompanied by Bill Ranford, his backup goalie. Fiore has quick reflexes and has great abilities at stopping 5 inches of frozen rubber traveling at speeds in excess of 100 miles per hour. Fiore and Ranford are the perfect goaltending teams, and this year, Juan Hayward are going down. But once more, pressure, one of the most gut-wrenching, head-pounding, nerve-wrecking variety, but has no effect on the world's greatest goalie, and that is Grant Fiore. When it comes to goaltending, Grant Fiore puts them all in the machine, especially Juan. Why I like him. I like Grant Fiore because of his technique and stopping abilities. Fiore has just the right stopping touch and stop just about anybody's shot. He's now out with shoulder injury, so Big Red will have to play beat up on the little Montreal Canadiens. Here's a description of Fiore. He's 5'10", he weighs 189 pounds, he shoots right. His home is Edmonton, and he plays
only 389 games in the average history.
My project's on Patrick Swayze. Patrick's career is more acting than real writing. In 1986, it was the beginning of Patrick's formal horse-showing career. He is a cow gutter. But all he does is try to keep one cow away from the rest by using a horse. He has won in many competitions and rodeos. He was also a star in the movie Dirty Dancing and wrote and recorded the top 10 song called Just Like the Wind in 1988. His favorite horse is Katsuki. Patrick was raised around horses in the Texas ranching lifestyle. Spacey's father competed in rodeos. Throughout his youth, Patrick roped a bulldog. His tutors are the mares, Tom, Rita, Dan, and Jamie. Long established in the reigning horse show industry, the mayor sold Patrick a Western Pleasure gelding. Intensified training sessions at the McNair's ranch, Patrick learned finesse in the saddle, walk, trot, and rope. When Patrick lacked in horseback knowledge, the McNair's groomed his technique. Leg cues, hand position, seat, and posture. Expertise in leads, gates, and horsemanship comes from years in the saddle. Schooling continued during the show. 3 hours were spent beside the practice pen. That first year, Swayze qualified for the NAHS, the National Arabian Horse Show, an amateur Western Pleasure, by placing in the top 5 of the regional division. Because he was filming Dirty Dancing during the nationals, his wife Lisa showed her gelding and placed in the top 10. Thank you.
Thank you.
Master is one of the best violin players in the canon. Betty has only one take of Jenny found before and has over 40 tunes on it. Betty got his violin when he was 3 years old at 10 years. From there, he started and learned to play from his mother and Jan Eric's daughter. When he was 12, he played his first public concert and has played many television. He has played at weddings, dances, funerals, and concerts. Plays music has taken him all over the world, like Ontario, Scotland, and all over the United States. Betty has worked as a station master from 1944 to 1988 or 89. Today, Betty is retired and still plays violin at concerts and other places. Today, he still loves Scottish music as much as ever.
My project is on John Fitzgerald Kennedy. John F. Kennedy entered politics because of his brother, Joseph, who was killed in a bomb. Joseph had entered politics before he died. In 1946, Kennedy ran for Congress. Although he ran against 9 other people, he won with 42% of the votes. He was 29 when he became a congressman. In 1952, he decided to run against Republican Senator Henry Cabot Lodge, Jr. He started campaigning 2 years early and met hundreds of thousands of people in Massachusetts. Kennedy beat Lodge by 70,000 votes. In 1953, he supported the St. Lawrence Seaway Project. Later in 1955, he was the only New England senator to support renewal of the reciprocal trade agreement. Also in 1953, he married Jacqueline Lee Boober. They had 3 children, Carolyn, John, and Patrick, who died less than 2 days after his birth. Kennedy tried for the 1960 Democratic presidential election. Many thought he was too young or that a Roman Catholic could not win a national election. Kennedy announced his candidacy early in 1960. By June, he had won 7 primary victories. The most important one was in West Virginia, where he proved that Roman Catholics could carry a mostly Protestant state. When the convention started, it appeared Kennedy's only challenge was Lyndon B. Johnson, Texas. Kennedy won in the first ballot and persuaded Johnson to be his running mate. 2 weeks later, the Republicans nominated Richard Nixon for president. Kennedy and Nixon faced each other in 4 televised debates. Many thought the debates won Kennedy the victory. Kennedy got 49.7% of the votes, while Nixon got 49.6% of the votes. It was the closest popular vote since 1888. It was inaugurated on January 20th, 1961. On June 3rd, 1961, in Vienna, Austria, Kennedy and Nikita Khrushchev met and reviewed relationships. Khrushchev had made it clear that he would find an even more belligerent policy to the U.S. In August, the Berlin Wall was built despite the protests of Kennedy and other Western leaders. On July 1962, Kennedy's ambassador, W. Averell Harriman, made an international agreement in Nails, which provided for a neutralist coalition government. In South Vietnam, however, it turned to war. In 1962, it was found out that Russia was sending Cuba offensive and defensive weapons. American troops prepared to invade Cuba, and American vessels blockaded Cuba. Soon after, Russia agreed to remove the weapons if America removed the barricade. On November 22nd, 1963, John F. Kennedy and his wife were in Dallas, Texas. They were in an open convertible, Governor John B. Connally and his wife in the front seat. Then two shots were fired, one going through Kennedy's neck and hitting Connally in the back. The other hit the president in the head. They rushed to the hospital, but at 1 p.m., John F. Kennedy was proclaimed dead.
Five new kids are Danny Wood, Jeffrey Katari, Donnie Wahlberg, Jordan Knight, and John Knight. Some of the songs they sing are The Right Stuff, Please Don't Go Girl, Cover Girl, Even Tabs, and Didn't Have My Mind Girl. Joe McIntyre. Joseph Muller McIntyre is his full name. He was born on December 31st, 1972. He has brown hair and blue eyes. He was the first member of NKOTV. He sings the lead vocals and Please Don't Go Girl. Jordan Knight. Jordan Knight is his full name. His birthday is on May 17, 1970. His eyes are dark brown and his hair is also brown. He writes songs with Donnie and Danny. Danny Wood. Real name, Danny William Wood. Danny was born on May 14, 1969. He was the mastermind and musical engineer. He is said to be especially deep and sensitive guy.
His blonde brown hair and hazel eyes. In his childhood, he was in two bands, Risk and Kool-Aid Punch, even before he began moving. For being new kids on the block, they were sure had no trouble making friends. And not only on their block, they got friends and bands worldwide. The kids are rare. discovered the more popular you are, the more hard you are. You have to work. And if you're band work means playing in concert, then. Originally, the new kids on the block were known as Nynuk. The kids have a home video out that includes the first four music videos on the roller concert page. Amy Tuff was the fourth single off the album of the same to reach number one position, marking the first top in pop history that any teen group has accomplished such a feat. First three singles after single with the record label, Be My Girl, Stop It Girl, Didn't I Blow You Up?
Victor Davis was born in Australia in 1962. He started swimming at a very young age. After years of drawing and hard practicing, he entered a competition. At the age of 10, he came first. This, to a lot of people, was just the beginning of a long and successful career for Victor Davis. After years of competing all over the world, he was becoming well-known to all Canadians. Victor Davis had a dream, and that dream was someday to make it to the Olympics. So he knew he had to train as hard as he could, and most of all, never stop dreaming. It paid off because at the age of 22, Victor Davis was on his way to the 1984 Olympics in Los Angeles. This, to him, was the most important thing that ever happened to him. Finally, the whole world was able to see Victor Davis swim. Suddenly, the Olympics, and Victor Davis weren't so happy anymore. He heard about the sudden death of his father. He still chose to swim, but this time he was doing it for his father. And to no one's surprise, Victor Davis won his first gold medal, then the next day his second gold medal. Canadians all over the world were proud to have Victor Davis as their swimmer. He retired after the 1984 Olympics, but was never forgotten. He was then known as one of Canadians' best swimmers. Then in November 1989, all Canadians were shocked to hear about the death of Victor Davis. He was a great Canadian and a great athlete. He may be gone forever, but he was always remembered for what he did to all Canadians in 1984. His two gold medals and the right to be one of the greatest swimmers of all time.
Summer Rita's albums are Flying on Our Own, Hear the Bells Ring, Reasons to Believe, and Rita. Rita McNeil's awards and achievements are she toured Japan, Britain, USA, and Canada. She's on the Tommy Hunter Show, which is a special. She had three platinum and two gold songs and albums. She performed for She won a Juno Award, a Stevie Award, she had a TV special Flying on Her Own. She won the most outstanding award of the decade. She's the headline singer for 16 years, 1985. And she performed at the Rick Hansen concert, and she performed with great artists and musicians.
Rita is a very down-to-earth person. She was born with the ability to sing. Rita always drew a large audience and captured their hearts. She could be classified as a female Hank Williams.
Rita has toured the globe. She's been to Canada, the US, Ireland, Scotland, Germany, Britain, Japan, Wales, Australia. Rita McNeil's from Big Pond, Cape Breton Island. When she was 17 years old, she moved to Toronto with her two children, Wade and Laura. Wade 20 and Laura 24, present age. Wade follows in his mother's footsteps as a musician. Laura is a college student.
Life was a hard struggle as a single mother in Toronto, waiting for her big break to come off. She scrubbed the floors, washed dishes, waited on tables, and sang in bars and nightclubs, also in women's rallies. She worked as a singer for 12 years without being paid. Rita never permanently lived in Toronto. She always came back to Cape Breton, her home, where she wrote all her own songs and got her inspiration for them.
When Rita had hardships in her life, an 11-year-old boy taught her the meaning of two words, courage and struggle. Rita has now successfully opened up a tea room in Bay Pond, and you'll probably see Rita, her family, and friends working there during the summer.
My project is on Ian Miller. Ian Miller was born in Halifax on January 6, 1947. Ian was just 8 years old when he first sat his dried pony for a photo which his mother still treasures. Ever since that day, he was horse crazy. Whenever the horse-drawn milk cart passed his home, he'd dash out the side and take a ride on it around the block. Black Beauty was his favorite book, and cowboys were his heroes. Then when his father, who was an army dentist, was transferred west, Miller had twice as much visions of riding on a ranch. Finally, in 1957, when Ian's parents took a summer cottage at Lacombe, Alberta, he got his wish. Socks and Flicka were two hacks a rancher kept inside a local general store for rent to the public. When Ian had wasted all his money, he made a deal with the rancher. The deal was that he would have unlimited riding privileges in exchange that he would have to work at the rental shop. Then at age 10, Ian Miller was in the horse business. The next 5 years, Ian spent at the Gordon School of Riding in Edmonton. From then on, Ian considered himself as a stable boy. He'd do anything, whether it was to muck up the stables, polish the tack, groom the horses, or help the blacksmith shoe. At age 15, when Ian's father was transferred east, he began training with Donovan at the Starshine Farm in the Ottawa Valley, riding show hunters with form and agility or empathy. At age 17, Woods took him as a partner, teaching him the ropes of blind horses as hunter and jumper prospects, then training them in selling. In September of 1983, Ian Miller bought a horse by the name of Big Ben in Holland on a horse-flying trip. Ian then made a decision to train Big Ben for the 1984 Olympics in Los Angeles. Ian Miller didn't have much time to train Big Ben, but he did and helped Canada place fourth in team competition. Over the next 5 years, Big Ben won one Grand Prix event after another, earning almost $800,000 in prize money. In 1986, Ian Miller was awarded the Order of Canada for his contributions to show jumping. Leader of the Canadian equestrian team since 1984, he's known to his colleagues as Captain Canada. For the future, Miller hopes to compete for at least another 10 years and plans on winning the 1993 exclusive Olympic gold with the help of Big Ben.
Alyssa Moran is better known as actress Samantha Roselli in this class. She has reached her 17th birthday on December 19th. She was born in 1972. Her brother's name is Lynn, her father's name is Tom, and her little brother, Gordon, is 7 years old. She has started college, and the reason is she would like to have something to fall back on if her acting career doesn't work out. She has been accepted to the college of her choice, which is the University of Toronto. She is 5'1 and manages to keep her body tip-top shape. Alyssa has taken the hearts of all Japanese people. Not only is she a great actress, but a great singer also. In addition to being on the Who's the Boss set, Alyssa has been attending Los Angeles private schools instead of when she has to be tutored on the set.
They have to handle both acting and schoolwork, so they prefer having on-set tutors without Alyssa. This busy brown-eyed gal is handling it with no problem. Keeping up with Alyssa's appointments would make anybody short of breath. Her favorite hockey team is the Los Angeles Kings.
She has also been awarded for her performance in Japan the Silver Award for song. Thank you.
Our projects are Jim McMahon.
Jim McMahon, important events, timeline. In 1967, Jim McMahon stabbed a fork through his eye and severed the retina while trying to untie a knot. Afraid that he would get in trouble, he waited 5 hours until his mother found him. From that day, he has suffered from eye trouble. In 1983, he was drafted by the Chicago Bears as the first-round quarterback. In 1985, he led the Chicago Bears to a 15-1 season and a 46-10 Super Bowl route over the New England Patriots. In 1989, he was traded to the San Diego Chargers for 2 first-round drafts, picks depending on his performance. They did not get the 2 first-round draft picks. They got 2 second-round picks. His natural abilities, throwing a football, leadership, inspires his team. Learned skills, playing football, being a father, and playing golf.
Favorite pastimes, golf, courtesy to tell the reporters off. Life history, Jim McMahon is a cocky, controversial quarterback. In 1967, when he was 7, he stabbed a fork through his eye and severed the retina. Afraid he would get in trouble, he waited 5 hours until his mother found him. Ever since, he suffered slightly from eye trouble. Later, in 1983, he was drafted by the Chicago Bears as a first-round draft pick. While he was with the Bears, he helped many charities and led his team to 5 Super Bowl playoffs in a row. In 1985, the Bears under McMahon had a terrific 15-1 season. And with the icing on the cake, they routed the New England Patriots 46-10 in Super Bowl 20. McMahon's favorite receiver in Super Bowl was Willie Goff. Even though Goff didn't catch any touchdown passes, he still caught 4 catches for 129 yards. In any game, all-time leading rusher Walter Payton was always McMahon's favorite running back. McMahon's known for his throwing, numerous injuries, his rotten relationship with his coach, and his cockiness with everyone. McMahon, his wife Nancy, and his children, Ashley 7 and Sean 4, make up the McMahon family. His trade to San Diego came at an interesting time, because he had just bought a $1 million mansion in Chicago, which he still uses in the offseason.
I'm John Fitzgerald Kennedy. John Fitzgerald Kennedy was the youngest man ever elected in president, and he was the youngest to die in office. President Kennedy was born on May 29, 1917. He came from a family of 8 children. John Fitzgerald Kennedy attended elementary schools in Brooklyn and Riverdale, Massachusetts. He entered Harvard University in 1936. There he majored his government and international relations. In 1951, Kennedy met his future wife, Jacqueline Jackie Lee Villiers. John Kennedy had 2 children, Carolyn and John F. Jr. On January 20, 1961, he was inaugurated president as he took charge of the federal government. He faced such international problems as increased social tension, unemployment, and a sluggish economy. Kennedy won world respect as the leader of the free world. He greatly increased United States prestige in 1962 when he turned aside the threat of an atomic war with the Soviet Union. During Kennedy's administration, the United States made its first manned space flights and prepared to send astronauts to the moon. Kennedy was shot to death by an assassin on November 22, 1963, as he rode through the streets of Dallas. He had only served 2 years and 10 months as chief executive. The sudden death of the young and vigorous American president shocked the world. Kennedy's body was brought back to the White House. Kennedy was buried with full military honors at Arlington National Cemetery across the Potomac River from Washington, D.C.
The titles of a rural Germany as a dictator from 1933 to 1945. He was born in 1889. He was one of the most evil men in world's history. Hitler turned Germany into a powerful war machine. Hitler spread death like no man has ever known before. Close your eyes to pity, act with him, and tell the soldiers. If anyone went against him, they'd be executed or thrown into prison.
Uniformed girls present these orders. These troops would often shoot the entire family or sometimes hundreds of people in town. Hitler really hated Jews, and he wanted them out of the countries he controlled. He set concentration camps for about 6 million Jews, and millions of other people were murdered. Many of the victims in these death camps were tortured before being killed. Others starved to death or died of disease. As a boy, Hitler sang the church choir and thought he would become a priest. But as an adult, he hated Christianity, which he said was a religion for widows. Hitler began his rise to power in 1919, the year after World War I ended. He told German empires had been defeated, and the economy of the country lay in ruins. Hitler became a leader of a small group of men who had organized the National Socialist German Workers' Party. Its members were called the Nazis. Hitler and his followers believed he could win back Germany's past glory. They promised to relieve Germany into a mighty empire that would last 1,000 years. Hitler's square black mustache, a lock of hair that hung down on his forehead, made him look like a common character to some people. But his fiery words and brilliant blue eyes seemed to hypnotize those who listened to him. Many of the Germans believed he was their friend and protector. His speeches given in high voices made crowds cheer for Hitler. After Hitler became dictator of Germany, he threatened war and lied to gain territory in Europe. The leaders of Great Britain, France, and other countries tried to stop war and let Hitler have his way at first. But they joined to fight when his need for power became too great. Hitler had a sick mind, but it was the mind of a genius. He had the daring to pursue and the talent to succeed. Hitler had no respect for any experts in any field. He repeatedly ignored the advice of generals and followed his own judgment. He continued to do so while Germany was being smashed into defeat in World War II. Finally, American, British, and Russian troops moved in on the part of Germany. Hitler killed himself. Eva Braun was Hitler's wife. They were married April 29, 1945, the week before Germany surrendered to the Allies. At Hitler's headquarters in Berlin, he had become a broken man. His head, hands, and feet trembled and tortured by stomach cramps. The day after Hitler's wedding, him and his wife committed suicide, swallowing poison. Hitler's aides burned bodies from gasoline.
You have two different speakers on.
Al McGinnis. Al McGinnis plays with the Calgary Flames and is number two. He has one of the hardest slap shots in the National Hockey League. Once he put a dent in the Hartford Whalers goalie mask from his hard shot. Last year he helped Calgary win Stanley Cup by contributing 31 points and led all other players in the playoffs. He was the first defenseman ever to lead in points in the playoffs. He was named the Conn Smythe winner. This year he is the highest paid Calgary player. He started the league in 1981-82 season and now has a career total of 416 points in 449 games played. A good description of Alan McGinnis is as follows. Height 6'2", weight 196, shoots right, last amateur club, Kitchener Rangers. Acquired first round choice, 15th overall in the 1981 draft. Born in July 11th, 1963 in the Inverness County Hospital. He was born right into a hockey family. He has two sisters and five brothers. All his fans in Portland cheer him on. He now lives in Calgary with his new wife, Jackie. Earlier last summer, he was charged for an incident in a bar in Calgary, but I think he shouldn't have been charged because it looked like a setup. Why I like him. I like Al McGinnis because when he was young, he did not have a good gear or anything, but tried his best and formed as a good hockey player at a young age. Also, I like him because he keeps his temper down on the ice and is really a role model. He is one of the handful of NHLers from Nova Scotia, but is the most respected. He now is 26 years of age and is a very good player considering where he came from.
If you think he holds his head, you should send him.
Ron Hextall is a goalie for the Philadelphia Flyers. He is from Winnipeg and is 26 years of age. He is one of the bigger goalies. He's 6'3", 180 pounds. Hextall helped the Flyers a lot when he played in His first year, he brought them to the finals, but he lost the game to the Edmonton Oilers of Smythe Division. But he received the Conn Smythe Trophy for the most valuable player for the playoffs. Ron Extall has a bad temper. He likes to fight or hit the players with a stick. He's gotten a lot of unnecessary penalties because of his temper. Last year in the 88-89 playoffs, his teammate Brian Propp was checked by Montreal's Chris Chelios and was knocked out and was taken to the hospital. The next game they played, Ron Extall went after Chelios and pounded him. After that, they gave him a 12-game suspension. There are also Ron Extall's good points. In his second year of play, he scored a goal and 6 assists, which no other goalie has ever done. And the next year, he scored a goal against Washington and had 7 assists. Ron Extall is one of the better goalies for the Flyers, besides Bernie Perron. Hopefully, someday, Ron Extall and his teammate, Ken Raggett, will also win the William Jennings Trophy for the best partnership instead of the Montreal Canadiens' Patrick Waugh and Brian Hayden.
Yeah, who wins?
Project, the fifth person we're doing is Napoleon. Napoleon was born on August 15, 1769, on the island of Corsica, in Agincourt. The son of Maria du Rancourt and Letizia Palomina. At the age of 10, he joined the military school. When he reached 16, he received a commissioner as a second lieutenant of artillery on January 17, 1886. His first act as a military consisted of the surrounding and falling of Toulon, a heavily guarded English area. For this, he was promoted. October 5th, 1795, he was appointed Barris, second in command, on the day of March 9th, 1796. Napoleon married Josephine, a girl from the West Indies. She was 6 years older than Napoleon, but he was determined to love her. Later in that year, he was called to command the French Army of Italy. He and his army raid through Italy, defeating ally after ally and forcing them back. In 1797, he defeated Austria, forcing them to surrender. More men were jealous of the heroes of Napoleon and tried everything to get rid of him. In July of 1798, France under Napoleon invaded Egypt. The Turks declared war on France. The British cut off Napoleon's army's food supplies. The British, the Turkish, and the Russians formed an alliance. The Austrians then re-entered the war, but again they were defeated, although just barely this time. In May of 1804, the French Senate voted him employer. On December 2nd, 1805, he smashed the Russian. Smashed the Russian and Austrian armies at.
When Napoleon returned to Paris, he divorced Josephine and remarried Archduchess Marie Louise. Okay. In 1811, she bore him a son, but things weren't so good on the battlefield. He was losing to the Allies. Napoleon lost his throne, then he was exiled for less than a year. Later, he returned to France and once again took control. He attacked Wellington at Waterloo, but the British defeated him. He fled but was captured and exiled once again, this time to St. Helena, where he later died of cancer. It was now May 5th, 1821. In 1840, his remains were moved back to France and laid in the dome of Église de Dôme. Here's a picture of Napoleon's.
Aim Alexander Graham Bell, birth date March 3rd, 1847, invention telephone, home
Edinburgh, Scotland, death August 3rd, 1922. Bell gave a lecture in Boston on speech by the deaf in 1871. Bell went into the Hall of Fame. He received an award at the International Centennial Exposition in Philadelphia. In 1877, he was awarded 50,000 francs and a membership of the Legion of Honor. In 1882, Bell finally became an American citizen. In 1877 to 1922, he received 30 letters from the U.S. government relating to telephone communication and instruction of staff. In 1865, Bell and his family moved to London, and in 1867, they moved to Toronto, Ontario.
In 1874, he discovered sail could travel along a wire with the help of electricity. February 14, 1876, Bell and Elish Gray filled out patent applications to invent the telephone. March 7, 1876, Bell's patent was issued, but in 1893, the Supreme Court ruled in his favor. The first sentence that was brought over the telephone by Alexander Graham Bell was March 10, 1876. In Bell's museum, there's an aircraft he started before his death. Also, you can watch movies about his life in the theater. Bell died near the deck of Nova Scotia, August 2nd, 1922.